I'm Digbir Jais, Vice President Research and International at the University of Manitoba. Welcome to the first Café Scientifique of our season. We have been doing these cafes at the McNally Robinson Bookstore in Winnipeg since the fall of 2008. So 8 years ago we started this program. We thought it was time to try something new this year. And with the Center on Aging's many research affiliates from Brandon University, we thought it's good to try it at Brandon. So that's why we are in Brandon to have a Café Scientifique. If you are in Winnipeg, I certainly extend invitation for you to join other cafes, which I have, we will continue to hold at McNally Robinson. The program was initiated by my office, and the main purpose of the program was to share the results of the research which is done by university researchers with the public and do it in a very friendly and comfortable environment. And I think the Senior Center is a perfect place, and I hope you agree that this is the perfect place to do a Café Scientifique, particularly in the topic we are talking about. We have a topic tonight very relevant to those living in Brandon region and to all Manitobans. We are all getting older, as I well know. The health implications are different for those living in rural communities versus city dwellers. Our panelists this evening will talk about their research and what research they have found and how that research could be applied to better the life of Manitobans. I would like to introduce your moderator for this evening, who will tell you more about the panelists and some of the ground rules that will guide the discussion this evening. But it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Michelle Porter. She is the director of the Center on Aging at the University of Manitoba. In addition to her duties as director, she is a professor in the Faculty of Kinesiology and Recreation Management at the University. She received her PhD in Kinesiology from the University of Western Ontario, her Master of Science degree in Community Health from the University of Toronto, and her Bachelor's degree in Physical and Health Education from Laurentian University. She spent her postdoctoral fellowship in Boston and Sweden. Michelle's work with older adults extends back to her undergraduate studies, where she volunteered and worked with older adults at residences and hospitals, and at academic research centers including Dr. Paul Schwan Center at the University of Regina and the Center of Activity and Aging at the University of Western Ontario. Multidisciplinarity of her research is matched by the diversity of her administrative experience at the University of Manitoba, serving as Associate Dean Research, Acting Dean, Graduate Program Chair, and Acting Director of two research institutes, including the Center on Aging from 2003 to 2004, and she began her term as current director in 2015. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Michelle Porter.
Thank you for that introduction, Digbir, and thanks to all of you for coming out tonight. We're thrilled to be here in Brandon for this cafe, and in particular, we're very pleased to be highlighting the work of three of our affiliates from here at Brandon University. I'm going to go through some of the ground rules or the plan for this evening, and then we'll get right started in to the panel. So each of our panelists are going to speak for about 5 minutes on their perspective on the topic of tonight. After all of the panelists have spoken, I'll then open up the floor for discussions or questions. And we will be passing around a wireless microphone so that everyone can hear all of the questions. And I should probably do a little sound check now. Can everyone hear me okay? Okay, great. I want to also let you know that if you look at the back of the room here, there is a video camera that's going to be recording this evening's discussions. It will be on us, so it's not going to be focused on any of you, but just a note that if you are asking questions, probably you don't want to share a whole lot of personal information because it will be recorded. It's going to be posted on the university's Café Scientifique website on YouTube. If you do want to share comments on social media, you can use the hashtag Café Scientifique. We're going to run until about 8:25 with questions, and then we'll wrap things up. As we've already said, there's refreshments available for you, and you can help yourself during the course of the evening. We also have some evaluation forms in all the tables, and we'd be really happy if you could fill out those forms for us. And I think we will get started with our first panelist then. And I'll introduce each panelist just before they're going to speak. So our first speaker for tonight is our longest serving research affiliate, Dr. Fran Racher. She's a professor here in the Department of Psychiatric Nursing and the Faculty of Health Studies at Brandon University. She's currently the coordinator of the Master of Psychiatric Nursing program. Her areas of research are rural population health, community development, gerontology, and access to health services. Dr. Racher has conducted research in all of her areas of interest, including studies in gerontology with elderly couples, sharing their experiences in residing in rural communities, in seeking health services, and in living with Alzheimer's disease. The Alzheimer's Society funded a more recent project called Living with Dementia, the Experiences of Older Couples and Managing Their Lives Together. Her previous nursing career included administration in long-term care and direct care nursing in rural communities. She holds a registered nursing diploma from Brandon General Hospital, a BSN and BA psychology from Brandon University, MSc in Community Health Sciences from the University of Manitoba, and a PhD in Nursing from the University of Calgary. She and her husband Doug have raised four daughters, are retired from farming, and enjoy spending time with their eight grandchildren. Thank you for being here, Fran, and take it away.
Thank you very much, Michelle. First, I'd like to say thank you to the Center on Aging and the University of Manitoba for coming out and hosting the Café Scientifique. And it's always good to have people come out and get to know Brandon and the rural area around here. And we're very happy to have you, so thank you for coming. And thanks to all those folks here that are coming to talk about these topics that are of such important interest to all of us. I'm going to just talk a little bit to start with about what I've done and why I did it and how I got involved in doing research in relation to older couples. I was the director of nursing in a small rural personal care home when two elderly individuals, a married couple, came and sat in my office and said to me, "We've been married for 65 years and one of us has been paneled to be admitted to your institution. And you're going to separate us, and it's really not what we would like," and they both began to cry. And in that very moment, I knew I was not going to separate them. And I said to them, "Okay, we'll have to find another way, and we're going to need to sort this out. In the meantime, we'll put both of you in the same room, and we'll figure this out, what we're going to do." Now, that's another story in terms of how we managed it, and back in those days, you could actually do that sort of thing. But then I began to wonder, what are the resources that are needed by elderly and older couples in rural communities in order for people to be able to stay together in their own homes? So that was the first study. And you know, I got this nice long list of important resources, but the most important finding of the study was that we don't look at older couples as partners. We don't take care of them as partners. We look after the individual who's receiving care, and we look after the caregiver, but we don't think about the fact that this is a couple, and they're a partnership, and they should have choices about whether they want to be together or whether they want to seek other ways of using resources. We don't give them those choices. So that was one of the most important learnings from that study, was about the importance of the relationship of the couple in contributing to their ability to remain what I would call interdependently independent in their own homes. So the next study that I was busy after that doing some work on access to health services, and the question came to me, now what is it like for elderly couples to access health services as a couple unit? How does this affect them? And again, went out and did interviews with several elderly couples over a period of time and found out that we don't do that great a job of service delivery to meet the needs of couples. And we need to look long and hard at the programs we have, the services we deliver, what those services look like, and how they meet the needs of older couples. So I've been sharing that information at various forums, and I find more and more healthcare providers are really starting to think about couples and be concerned about the couple as a unit of care. And that's huge. We need to think about each of the individuals and also about the couple as a unit. So then an opportunity came along. It was a call for funding from the Alzheimer's Society. And the question that went to my mind was, what is it like for a couple to live with dementia? Because in all truthfulness, when one of the partners has dementia, the couple lives with dementia. Again, we did a study, and I can't tell you how important it is to do research with older people, because they will tell you what you need to know. They are wonderful sources of knowledge and information, and it's an excellent way for us to learn and how to do better programming, better service delivery. So out of this, we got some really good information on how to work with couples, and I will tell you that there's a tip sheet that we've used and shared with the Alzheimer's Society. Tips for family, tips for the service providers, tips for the community, in how much your support of your friends and neighbors is important when you're living with dementia. So I've put both of those there. People are welcome to help themselves. But the other wonderful thing I want to tell you about is that we started this Master's of Psychiatric Nursing at Brandon University, and two of the students did the data collection on the last study. They were both so intrigued by the issues that these couples living with dementia were experiencing. The one student has now, for her thesis, studied the transition of relocation to a long-term care facility and what that's like for a couple. I have another student who's currently working on palliative care in relation to living with dementia. And what's that like for a couple? And how does a family manage that phase of their life and their trajectory? So we're seeing these issues and more interest. We're seeing now that graduate programs, and I know U of M's had a graduate program for a long time in various faculties, all contributing to gerontology. So that's wonderful, and it's been ongoing. But now Brandon University can contribute too in our graduate program in psychiatric nursing. So I'd just like to say we've got a lot of work to do. But if we take time to talk to older people and older couples, there's a lot to be learned from them, and the work that we do in relation to that can be most beneficial in better program delivery, better policy development, and better services for all.
Thank you very much, Fran. And so, as I said, we're going to move through each of the panelists, then we'll have lots of time for discussion when all three are done. So our next speaker, convenient, it's not in the right chairs for this, worked out well, is Dr. Rachel Herron. She's an assistant professor in the Department of Geography, Faculty of Science at Brandon University. Dr. Herron specializes in health geography and rural health and aging research. She obtained her doctoral degree from Queen's University and has an MA in Canadian and Indigenous Studies from Trent University. Broadly speaking, she is interested in how we can make rural communities better places to grow old. Her research has explored the challenges of negotiating support from the perspective of older people and their caregivers, the role of the voluntary sector in the provision of care, the ethics of doing research with vulnerable populations, gender, dimensions of caregiving, and more, most recently, support for people living with dementia in rural communities. Her current research includes a project which examines how partners in care provide how partners in care for people with dementia understand and respond to reactive behaviors. So for example, hitting, spitting, and swearing in different environments such as the home, community center settings, and alternative care settings. Thank you for being here, Rachel.
Thank you. Like Fran, I'll start with my interest and where this came from. Aging finds us all eventually. It just happened to find me a little bit early. I became interested in aging partially because I grew up in a rural setting, which we know in general around the world, rural places tend to be proportionately older than urban settings. And so it was really my interest in rural health that somehow directed me towards aging and dementia. I started in my master's looking at older individuals trying to find the support that they needed to age in their communities. And then I had them nominate a caregiver to talk to and interview these individuals separately to see how they were finding the support that they needed and how the caregiver was finding the demands of responding to those support needs. And that's when I met some really wonderful caregivers for people with dementia. And I was really struck by their stories. So struck by their stories that I almost didn't want to finish my master's. I wanted to go on to a new project right away. And so that led me on a path toward Queen's University, where I spent 4 years studying access to care in rural places across Ontario. I did a survey of the Alzheimer's Society's 34 of them in Ontario to look at the variation services across the province. There's a lot of variation, particularly in services for people in rural settings. Often fewer supports directed towards the earlier stages of dementia, which are sorely needed. And there's often a lot of problems associated, of course, with end-of-life care. So we're sort of fraying at the edges, if you want to put it that way. So I looked at service providers' perspectives, as well as the perspectives of people with dementia themselves. Who were keen to be more involved. They wanted things to do. They wanted to volunteer in their communities. They still had a lot to offer, but they faced challenges of transportation. Many of them had lost their licenses, but still had a lot that they could contribute. Some people still actively baked for the church. They were familiar with those spaces. They'd been moving around there for 40 years. And so I got to see a lot of energy and enthusiasm while working with people with dementia. But in the same token, I also saw the constraints that their partners in care were facing. They found that they couldn't get out of the house, or they couldn't be in the house alone. So I'm interested in those constraints, and like Fran, I see the need to look at care from a relational perspective. And not necessarily in terms of person-centered care, but in terms of the relationships in which care takes place, because care is always a relationship. And so I've been looking at this most recently around reactive behaviors. So what I found when I was talking to a subset of people who were former caregivers about their experiences throughout the condition was that many of them struggled long after with their experiences of violence and aggression. Now, they were incredibly understanding of their partner, who they'd spent 20, 30, 60 years with, but they were still coping with physical and emotional bruises from those extreme behavioral changes and the demands that that placed on them. And also a sense that if they had been able to keep that person with dementia out of long-term care, they might have had a better life in the end. So this has really directed my attention towards the role that our home environments play and transition to alternative settings of care play in managing these sorts of reactive behaviors. Often these behaviors at home precipitate the transition to long-term care, but once in long-term care, the behaviors are worsened. It's an unfamiliar environment with unfamiliar people. So how can we make that transition better? And how does knowledge from the partner in care at home and knowledge about the environment come together to make care better? So I guess I'll stop with that project and
thank you. So our final panelist is Dr. Nancy Newell. She's an assistant professor in the Department of Psychology, Faculty of Science at Brandon University, and is a research affiliate with the Center on Aging at the University of Manitoba. Her work has examined some of the causes of loneliness, as well as the consequences of loneliness for older Manitobans in terms of health and longevity. Most recently, she's turned her attention to exploring what types of services or interventions might help people become less lonely or isolated and more socially connected.
Thank you, everybody. Thanks for being here. I guess we've all got our reasons for why we study what we study. For me, it was actually one of the main reasons I started to become interested in loneliness was because of my grandma Newell, my dad's mom. And it was because she wasn't lonely. another reason is my background is psychology, and I was fascinated by this. So this was part of why wasn't my grandma Newell lonely? She'd be what I would call a lifelong isolate. Someone who, as far as I knew, now I only met her when I was born, so she was in her 70s at the time. My understanding is she didn't change suddenly when she was older. She didn't become more, she didn't change in terms of wanting solitude all of a sudden. My understanding is that throughout her life, she really didn't have a lot of contact. She had a good friend who unfortunately died when she was in her 70s. She moved to Victoria, where I grew up, to be closer to my dad and family, but to be honest, she didn't see us that much, and to a great extent, it was her choice, she had a good network of social workers, actually, because of connections with home care for some of health problems that she was experiencing, and they ended up getting her a really good spot in an assisted living residence, with the concept. I was interested, there was some data at the time showing that loneliness predicted health, and I wanted to see if that would be the case. I wanted to look in, I was fortunate enough to be able to have access to the Aging in Manitoba data set, which was spearheaded by the late Betty Havens. And so I looked at loneliness and how it predicted health and in terms of numbers of chronic conditions older people might have, as well as their longevity. And I indeed found that that loneliness was a strong predictor, even impacting potentially the number of years that people live. And my research replicated to a good extent other research out there at the time. At the same time, there were some game changers, I think, happening. So interestingly enough, there was someone out of Chicago named Cassiopo, who was basically a powerhouse of research, and he was putting out a lot of publications around how loneliness could directly impact our bodies. So we see that loneliness impacts health. How? He was studying actually the physiological impacts of loneliness. I think it was a game changer, actually, in the area. Another game changer was a meta-analysis that came out that basically sifted through about hundreds of studies looking at how social relationships impact mortality. And it was one of the most strongly worded research articles I've read. Researchers, we typically like to say we need more research that needs to be done, right? This was strongly worded. It said, listen, folks, we've got enough research that shows that social relationships, including isolation and loneliness, impact our mortality, impact our health. Enough of this. And so myself, looking at it in older Manitobans, the research literature as a whole, I've started to say, we've got the evidence that suggests that loneliness impacts our health. It's an important issue to study. The next question in the shift in the literature and where I've turned my focus is, what are we going to do with that information? So when I started to think about that, one of the smartest things I did was realize I'm not the expert. I wanted to turn to the expert, which is the front line. So Age and Opportunity, there's two members here tonight, allowed me to collaborate with them and actually look at what is already being done in the community. And what I wanted to do with them is to look at what they're doing and see if we can evaluate it, find out what's working in terms of intervention and for whom. And so that's where I've shifted my focus, and I'd be happy to talk more about that. Thanks.
Okay, so now we're going to move to the interactive portion of this evening. So it's your opportunity to share your own knowledge, your own experiences, ask questions of the panelists. But certainly this is an opportunity for knowledge exchange, so we don't hold all of the knowledge up here with the panel. There's lots of knowledge out here in the room, so we'd be happy to hear not just your questions, but also your experiences, etc. So, we have a question up here at the front. So we're going to bring the microphone around so that everyone can hear the question.
I'd like to direct this to Dr. Nancy Newell. You just made reference to two things in the Brandon community that you're looking at. Are you looking at the age-friendly community and MASC? Or what two areas did you refer to?
In the Brandon community. I didn't mention two areas in Brandon community, but so I'm not sure if I understand your question, but I am the connection between age-friendly and age-friendly Brandon too, and addressing isolation and loneliness are hand-in-hand in my mind. Creating age-friendly communities are fostering, theoretically at least, social participation. That's one of its main goals as an age-friendly community. So I feel they're hand in hand. I'm not sure if I'm answering your question, though. I'm sorry.
I think you are.
Okay.
Now that was one. Now you said there were two. And I'm just wondering what the second one was.
The organization that I'm working with, maybe, is that what you're referring to?
And what organization?
It was Age and Opportunity, A&O.
A&O?
A&O, yeah.
And is that in?
That's in Winnipeg. I was pointing over there because two of the members are here tonight.
Oh, okay.
And tomorrow I'll be talking a bit more about the program. The programming does extend to all of Manitoba, though. It's Winnipeg based, but some of the programming extends all across Manitoba.
Yes, you did answer. Thank
okay.
you.
Other questions? Yes, okay. We'll bring the mic over to you.
I have a husband who has a disability, and my concern for him is mobility, in that he no longer has a driver's license. I take him everywhere, or somebody else takes him if he needs to go beyond. But in the wintertime, he's stuck, unless I take him or somebody else takes him, because his mobility is no longer his own. What are people doing to address these issues? Like, we're in a small town, so, but even in the city, when he was in the city, getting around, the streets were just not conducive to a wheelchair.
Again, I think I'm happy the age-friendly banner is here, because I think age-friendly, one of its mandates is to try to address things like transportation, for example. And I think it's creating community and creating the environment that can facilitate social participation, for example. So that would be one way I would...
There are some organizations, there's a little banner over there. So the Transportation Option Network for Seniors is certainly advocating on behalf of seniors trying to improve the situation, but there's a group of us on the board. We certainly realize that there are lots of challenges out there. We ourselves experience them. We certainly know that people are, and I think it's going to take people's voices for to really getting at the people who clear the sidewalks, etc. And I think with the new Accessibility Act in this province, I think that will be a real push for really saying, no, this isn't just a luxury. Clearing sidewalks is not a luxury. It isn't, you know, it's an accessibility issue. It's an allowing people to actually live their lives the way that they need to. It's the way the situation is now. There are many systemic barriers in place, and so I think through activities like the age-friendly communities, that lots of work still needs to be done, and I think, you know, we can all have to get our voices out there to make sure that we're conveying that, you know, these issues of mobility, they're not a luxury. It's a major part of someone's life. And certainly the center, we're hoping to do some projects specifically around a new tool that's available. We haven't got funding for this yet, but we're hoping to do a project that specifically is going to address winter mobility and getting around, not by transit or other things, but around on sidewalks and things, and conveying some of this information. So hopefully through that research and the work of age-friendly communities will improve the situation.
Could I just add to that in the PAW, they had about a year or two ago, they actually had the mayor go in a wheelchair and experience getting around on the sidewalks in the winter time, and of course he couldn't. So something like that, if you have an opportunity to get your town council or to actually experience what it's like to be on crutches or to be in a wheelchair, suddenly the light bulb goes on and goes, oh my goodness, we've got to do something better here. And also with some of your little businesses, so they can realize how difficult it is for people to get in.
Well, we have a whole two blocks, and they're not cleared in the
So, like, I'm as one of our distinguished speakers who spent time in Kingston can speak to, Kingston for probably 20, perhaps 25 years, if not more, not to age myself too much, but is required by virtue of a city bylaw that you clear the sidewalks. And not only that, but if you do not, there's a significant fine associated with that. And what it does is it changes the culture of the community and forces people to clear their sidewalks. Now, there's some caveats to that. If you're like unable to clear the sidewalk, therefore you do not have to, but it's still your responsibility to then organize to make that happen. And this is in Kingston, where everything is older than kingdom come, and nothing can change that Sir John A. ever touched, right? Every place that he peed on the street is sacred. So if it can happen in Kingston, where things are very, very unchanging, then I think it can happen in rural Manitoba.
Just like to address that a little bit to Jewel here. I'm the resorts coordinator in that same town for seniors. We have a bit of an issue on that street. The town says it's the Department of Highways. It's owned by the Department of Highways. The Department of Highways says it's the town's problem. I've worked on that. Not an easy project. But we definitely have sympathy for our gunner.
Good evening. It's interesting topics you have. I am still a little bit confused what the Café Scientifique is supposed to do. Is it advocating for something? Is it just presenting research? Because the research is certainly interesting in itself, but I'm not sure how that impacts on age-friendly matters. What are we doing with that information once we have it? For example, I know several people who are older and some younger who are social isolates. And I also know people who are social butterflies. And they both are getting along very well. in life, perhaps better than I am. And so, what does this tell us then? I mean, there's another underlying something or other that is acting here on both of them that causes them to be happy and satisfied with where they're at. What is it? I have no idea. But I would like to have either one of those situations in my own life, because they're apparently happy. Appear to be happy at any rate. Perhaps one is not going to live as long as the other, but they'll live as long as they're going to live happy. So my question is, what is the purpose of Café Scientifique? Is it to bring this information to our attention, or is it... that's where I'm at. What is it?
I'll take a stab at answering that question. I think, for me, this is an incredible opportunity to engage with that very question and say, you know what, I have a skill set as a researcher. There's lots of ways that we can look at things, but what do you want us to look at? What speaks to you? You know, I come here with a set of research findings, but I also come here with this skill set asking, how can I put that skill set in service of you, your local community, your friends, so that we can make that difference? So, you know, I'd sort of turn your question right back to you. What do you think we could do differently?
Did you want the microphone?
Well, I could ask a question again, but a different one, perhaps. Your information could lead to some productive issues. For example, in rural Manitoba, to my way of thinking, the most overarching issue is, in fact, transportation. Because without transportation, you can't get to the health services. You can't get to your friends and the activities that allow you to socialize. You can't get to the mail. You can't get to shop for groceries. I mean, those are critical things. Now, how does one address that? I know there's one community that has an organization, a service organization, that runs a bus service for shopping, for medical, and you name it. They do that. Now, what is it? What are some of the answers that come out of what it is that you do, and what it is that you've done? Because I'm sure there are some good answers. Somebody mentioned transportation, and that, I think, is the first thing that has to be addressed. Perhaps housing is another one eventually, and medical, and so on. But, going down to medical. Then it's difficult, according to some friends of mine, to try and get information from personal care homes in terms of the issues that they face. I know they get the criminal record checks and all of that sort of thing, but is there any protection for somebody who complains about the way they've been dealt with, lack of respect, whatever it is, perhaps even assaults, because they're afraid of retaliation, they're afraid of, where does it go? Where does that information go to? Is it accessible to me and my wife if she wants to put me away somewhere? Is it accessible to her as to what is happening in that personal care home? And the first thing comes about is, well, it's FIPA. It prevents us from doing that. Yet FIPA doesn't prevent us from doing all sorts of things in terms of getting my information. Those kind of things, I think, are really important. We do not get good information from the people that are around us, whether it's social services, whether it's like to find out how to go about getting into a personal care home is like pulling teeth. You know, where are they located? How do you get into? There's so many stages that you have to go through, and none of those are clearly defined to anybody. Maybe they need a personal care home navigator who knows these things and knows how to get from A to B in terms of personal care homes. But how do we get the information that they have or should have? And do they report them to the police? What happens to those complaints that people have? What's the medication like? Are they over-medicated, under-medicated? I know sedatives are a pretty nice thing to have if you have an overactive individual, whether it's with Alzheimer's or whatever. But that isn't necessarily the way to go. Anyway, thank you.
I'll tackle the transportation piece first and then make a comment on the second, if that would be okay. I've worked with a lot of rural communities, and I'm really interested in rural community development, and one of the major issues in rural communities is transportation. And oftentimes, not only is there not a bus service, but there isn't a cab service or a taxi service available. But you know, rural people are pretty smart, and by talking from one community to another, you might find some really interesting solutions. I know one community where the school buses, between school term, between when the students are dropped off and the students go home at the end of the day, they use the school buses as public transportation in their community. I know another community that has a really successful cab service because the taxi driver carries a shovel, and he shovels the walkway to pick up his fare. So, you know, there are communities that are looking at solutions and people who are coming together. Your seniors' organizations often have a list of volunteer drivers, a list of people who are prepared to be volunteers and help in various ways. So for me, there's various levels. There's the level of what can we do ourselves as members of a community, and how can we influence the streets and talk to our own counselors and get together and demand to be heard and demonstrate the pushing of the wheelchair, if you will, or the riding in the wheelchair. What do we do about creating ideas? You know, I had a person say to me once, Brandon needs a nice swimming pool like what's out in Souris. That's, you know, it's great that, you know, all these people can go out there and enjoy and bring their children and enjoy that wonderful pool. Council should get us a swimming center like that here in Brandon. And I said to them, you know what, it wasn't council that got it out in Souris. It was the community members who got together and said, we want a pool for our kids. And we're going to work together, and we're going to fundraise, and we're going to involve people, and we're going to solve our own problems, and we're not going to count on council to do it for us. So that's one level. There is the level, what can council do, and you need to knock on their door and tell them what you expect of them. Another level is, what can the government services do? Now here in Brandon, there's home care, and there's proctor services for seniors. Proctor services can take people out of their homes and take them out. What we found with our elderly couples was that the spouse who needed respite wanted to stay home and put their feet up. And the spouse that had dementia needed to get out and about and use up some energy and have some fun and enjoy their day. Proctor services, with mental health services for the elderly, and I think it's got a new name now, we found that we had a particular gentleman in this community that was doing a phenomenal job as a proctor. He picked up a farmer from his home. This farmer had dementia and a past history of being a pilot. So they would go out to the airport and watch the planes take off. They'd go crop inspecting. They'd go for coffee in the rural communities around, because you know what the coffee shops are like in our rural communities. They're a great place to visit. So I question, how come we don't have proctor services in rural communities? We've got them in Brandon, and maybe not enough of them here as well. So to me, there's all these different levels of things we need to look at in terms of our issues. And we need to work together, and we need to speak together, and we need to raise our voices together in order to get things fixed. So that's my transportation spiel. And I believe very strongly that I was born and raised in Souris. So I didn't get very far from home. This is home for me. And I have a sister out there that comes in, they have a handy van that comes in on a certain day of the week to Brandon and brings people in to shop. But they have to skittle back to town because they also pick up people for the adult day program, so they have to get back in time to... So, you know, the community needs to get better at figuring out, we have problems with this, what are our solutions, and sit down and problem solve, because seniors have got really good minds, and they've got really good ideas, and I believe they can come up with some things that need to be done. With regards to personal care homes, and I have been a director of nursing in a personal care home, and I can tell you one instance which disturbed me to no end, where someone came in, took a look at one of our elderly gentlemen who was obesely overweight, and I got a phone call from the Minister of Health wanting to know how come we had this individual who was so overweight. So you would be surprised how some of these things move through the system, because this gentleman had come to us this way and in fact was losing weight. But I was called on the carpet to explain what was going on and how we were providing care. We did have instances where people were abused, and we took action. Our responsibility is proper care of every resident that's in our care. And abuse is not tolerated, zero tolerance. So if there are issues of that, you speak to the nurse in charge, you speak to the director of nursing, and action will be taken. Investigation will be done, and action will be taken. So I encourage you to have that communication if the need is there, because people are receptive to that, and they take that very seriously.
How many have not heard of proctor care? We need to have those bits of information.
Yeah, I agree. And proctor care, in terms of what I study in isolation loneliness, I think when I first heard about it, I just heard about it when I'm new to Brandon. So, the idea that you can actually have someone that's supporting a person, but also if it's a couple, right? Giving them.
I can't tell if Brandon thinks himself as a city or right? Like there's so weird. I'm not from here. It can be weird and uncomfortable sometimes. When I think it thinks it's Prairie.
I really appreciate your question as the resident geographer here. Although I'm sure Fran could speak volumes about this issue as well. I teach a course on rural and small town Canada, and it's one of the delights of having moved here and having position at BU, because all of my students come from rural and small town settings. Now, Statistics Canada defines rural as a population of 1,000 or less. Rural and small town is 10,000 or less. But we can think about rural in terms of these descriptive definitions that focus on measurements of population density and size. We can also think of rural as something that's social and cultural. And arguably, if you talk to any of my students, Brandon is incredibly rural. I think it's hilarious. I took a picture of the sign. There's a sign on Victoria, and I live on 16th. It's close to, I think it's between 16th and 15th. So you're literally in the core, driving down the street, and it's like a sign that says Minnedosa, this way, Boys of Ain, that way. It's like you're in the core, and all it tells you is where the rural places are. So it's a good question. I think we live in a place that is, you know, rural, at least historically, but also culturally and socially here in Brandon. And we serve a huge rural, you know, countryside surrounding us. So it's an important issue to discuss.
Many of you may remember Glenn Chapman, who was the administrator of the hospital for many years. Glenn used to call Brandon Rurban. That was his way of being inclusive, because he got it. But I can tell you that I basically got a substantial government grant from CIHR. We had a conference in Halifax to look at how do you define rural with the use of large databases. And we brought in people from Australia, because they got lots of rural. We brought in people from the U.S. And what we found was a lot of the definitions of rural, there's the bigger range is within each of those definitions than the differences between the two categories. Because if you use Stats Canada, that anything that's more than 1,000 is urban. You've got places like Souris in the same category as Toronto.
Yeah.
You know, so you're right about definitions. They can be really a concern. For me, rural is wonderful. So to consider Brandon rural is a compliment. But for people maybe who live in Winnipeg, they don't necessarily see rural as pardon me? Are on the moon. We are on the moon to some folks inside the perimeter. But the other thing to remember is a lot of the people that live here came from small rural communities. So their hearts are rural, even though they may have their feet on what might be considered more urban ground.
Just a quick comment on rural. Having come from that dreaded area of southern Ontario, and I certainly understand where the one professor, I know both universities very well, I almost feel that Manitoba is Winnipeg and everything else, as Ontario would be Toronto and everywhere else. The challenge is, it's fine to be in Winnipeg, it's fine to have all these resources in Winnipeg, but you try and bring them outside of Winnipeg, and all we're hearing is cutbacks, cutbacks. One lady mentioned Greyhound. I rode Greyhound for years, having to go in for medical procedures. If I want to take Greyhound now, 5:15 in the morning is the only bus you can take to go in, unless you want to go in at 7:30 at night and try and get a hotel room. So the challenge has been the cutbacks, and there's been nothing to fill that need.
There used to be a federal department called the Rural Secretariat. And any policies that were being considered, they had to think about them in terms of rural communities and what they meant to rural communities. The last government disbanded it. It was actually a child of Ralph Goodale's way back in the day, coming from Saskatchewan. But it was important in that policy that was being passed had to consider the impact on rural communities. And so, to me, that's a real loss, because I think some of your transportation issues about buses, etc., some of the policies that start happening in relation to those sorts of issues, really are part of that issue of we're the minority in rural. And, you know, the bell went off for me the day that I actually sat down with the figures and said to myself, more than half of the population of Manitoba resides in Winnipeg. They have a local government with as much clout as the provincial government, basically. And that's a scary business in Manitoba. So rural people need to get together and get their voices heard, as opposed to all of the isolation that we sometimes feel in rural communities.
Can I just complicate this further? I'm working in Brandon as a prof, and I live in Winnipeg, so I'm understanding rural as I drive it every day pretty well. But you're right, I like your question and whispered question around Brandon and rural. But to complicate this discussion is the fascination for me, what I find when I talk to people in Winnipeg. Much of my research is done in Winnipeg. Transportation is a huge factor in Winnipeg, absolutely huge as well. So locked buildings, right? How do you? It's systematic, because it's happening in bigger cities as well. So the transportation issue is incredible. And for those of you who are on age-friendly committees, and if you had town halls, which age-friendly did around Manitoba, transportation was practically always number one, next to housing. I really appreciated your comment about the tsunami idea. And I teach a course called Psychiology of Aging, and a piece of that is on demographics. And I put up a picture of a beach from somewhere in Manitoba, I can't remember now, one of our beaches. And I say, if it's a tsunami, we've been watching it coming for a long time. You know, so to use this language now, and I just saw actually in the Winnipeg Free Press, my partner cut out a cartoon, and it had that same image, the gray tsunami. It was a wave on the beach, and I thought, really? Are we really talking about that? We've been watching it come for so long.
Way behind.
One final comment on the issue of transportation in rural. So what I see from
I work with Transportation Options Network for Seniors, and we support individual communities. We try to make sure that they are aware that they can, in fact, apply to have a handy van, which certainly helps. But one of the things that's missing in all of this is that handy vans are passing each other on the highway, going to Brandon or to Winnipeg because someone has a health need. And there's no coordination of these services. So I look at this and go, well, you know, we're just wearing out these handy vans because literally almost every week there's a handy van from virtually, there's 69 rural handy van programs in rural Manitoba. And literally that's what they do. They beetle people around town, and that's so important. And social, you know, to get them out and just even have coffee with a friend, get them to groceries, get to the bank, do all the things that they might not be able to do if they no longer drive. But it makes no sense to me that we can't somehow figure out how to coordinate these rides. It just drives me nuts.
Specialist, and the specialist comes into Brandon, but they tell me that there's too long a waiting list for me to see the specialist in Brandon, so every month I go to Winnipeg, which costs the taxpayer a lot more money, and so this is ridiculous. Somehow you have to get that service attended, and that's almost what this lady is saying as well. That's my personal one. We're talking, there was no aging. Is somebody my age, you know, aging, and if you read in your own articles, aging can begin at any age. And so I think that you have to talk a little bit more about, across the board, about aging and at what age they are. And we all can suffer from the same things. There are active people like me at my age, and there are people at 40 who don't do anything like I do. And so they are aging. So I'd like you to just talk a little bit about the aging and the aging, how it starts, and signs that you might look for if you have a family.
Yeah, I mean, in a lot of ways, we're encountering people in our research at a certain age, maybe 70 or 80 or beyond. And in some cases, we don't know the background of that individual. So my idea about lifelong isolate, for example, the social workers who were encountering my grandma were coming in with the supposition that she would want a certain service or need certain services even, and probably very confused as to why my grandma was basically refusing services. Maybe they were just as aggravated as she was. But the fact that they were encountering her when she was in her 90s, you know, having lived already 90 years, not knowing the history of people that way. In my area where I'm talking about and looking at people who are, we're encountering the extremely isolated, so people that might not have any contact at all. My curiosity in terms of encountering individuals who are extremely isolated and also suffering from mental health issues. Again, we're encountering that. We're not clear on whether the mental health issue has been with them since they were in their 20s, for example. So have the mental health issue exacerbated or caused the isolation, for example, or is the, you know, has the isolation caused the mental health issue? That's a question that we don't know when we're just looking at someone in later life. Those are good questions, though.
I just wanted to comment briefly as well.
No, go ahead.
I just wanted to comment briefly as well and say that in my work around dementia, I certainly met people who have early onset dementia, and in terms of looking at service needs and barriers to service, it's a very different kind of portrait that you're painting there. You know, you're meeting people who have teenage children still living at home, they're still trying to figure out how they can work for as long as they can, and if they can't work, how they're going to negotiate supporting those kids, and all the things that you associate with that. So, these sort of aging issues become complicated, and they aren't as clear-cut as
as maybe some people think they are.
I'd like to just switch part of the focus on this for a minute. You've been dealing in couples and partners, but I guess where I'm looking at is someone who is has come to Manitoba, and there is no support network, and that person is totally, like, they're fine as far as a small circle of acquaintances, friends, but in a lot of areas, there are people who are single, alone, and don't have a support network. And there's going to come a time, and I'm one of them, there isn't a support network. There isn't a family I can rely on. There isn't anyone that I would really, trust as far as going for help. And so there comes the time that some of these people are going to need someone, and that nice little safety net that families have, that families use,
not always is there.
Yeah.
Even when the families are present, sometimes it's not there. Yeah.
So maybe address, singles who are trying to find help and may need it somewhere down the road.
And again, being a voice, I agree with Fran in a lot of ways, being a voice for where you live and where your community is. I'm not sure where you live, but okay, Miranda, right. No, you're right. There's going to be people who are living alone. Living alone is one of the biggest risk factors to being lonely, right? Not everyone who lives alone is lonely, but it's a major risk factor. We haven't brought up the idea of housing yet. Housing is a huge issue, and I'm actually beginning, and I've been hearing it from people that I've interviewed as well, some people just might not want to live alone, and yet that's the way we've set up our society in a lot of ways. Independence equals living alone in a lot of ways. In a lot of ways, I think. So some of the people I've talked to, I would say they may be the younger seniors that are looking at alternative ways of living and housing in general. And again, I think that can come from you as community members, as voices. Developers are continuing to create those boxes that we can lock up, maybe. And it's not, they're not made for people necessarily. I was fortunate to hear an architect speak about age-friendly, and he basically said, he's an architect, and he said that in a lot of cases, cities are not built for people. They actually see people as a nuisance, right? So I guess bringing it to that discussion as well. There might be resources available for you. I think the gentleman who said that we need to do a better job at communicating what's available for people, for example. And I'm going to talk about one of the programs that's offered across Manitoba. That's a telephone. It's designed for people who might not be able to be mobile to get to a senior center. So it's called a Senior Center Without Walls. It's offered by Age and Opportunity. But I think I'm wondering how has it gone around in terms of people knowing about it. So I'll be talking about that tomorrow. From a research point of view, but Age and Opportunity is here tonight as well. And actually, when I did look at that and interview people that were taking part in the Senior Center Without Walls, there was a few couples that I interviewed that were what they would call geographically isolated. And so they were taking part in the telephone, it's basically a telephone programming over the phone. It's called Senior Center Without Walls because it's supposed to be offering senior center type activities, but it goes into your home, it's through your telephone, something that most people might have. If you want more information about that, you can ask me later, or if you're coming to my talk tomorrow, I can tell you more about it as well. But I think that that communication piece, there might be things that you might be interested in, Brandon, that we just aren't telling each other about, right?
Time for maybe one more question.
Well, this gentleman's been waiting forever and ever.
I have concerns about how elderly people access emergency wards. I've had to go there, attend with my parents on a few occasions. Many times, if they don't have somebody to advocate for them, they could be sent home right away. Or, as my mother was having, she was having pains. Of course, they said, well, it's just rib pain. So this was getting later on in the evening, and I said, you know, what are you going to do? And they said, well, she's going to go home tonight. I said, well, I'm not comfortable sending her home. She's over 90. My father was not able to look after her. So I said, I think you need to find a bed for her. Well, no, there are no beds for her. So I just persisted because I knew my father couldn't look after her. And I suspected she was having a heart attack. She had right arm pain. The doctor said, you can't have a heart attack. Women don't have heart attacks with right arm pain. I said, well, I did. And I know that she could be having a heart attack, however mild it was. So I said, please find out if you can keep her overnight. Finally, after about a half an hour, he came back and said, we have found a bed for her. I said, well, thank you. And took my father home. Next day, they found out she did have a heart attack. And at the age she was at, her dementia was getting fairly bad. So we were able at that point in time to work with her doctor and the hospital, and she ended up being found. But my father then was left alone. He would not accept or access the emergency department. He would go to his doctor, maybe. His doctor was just thought he was well all the time, never spent much time with him. So then, of course, you know, I was the only advocate to be able to go with him. So if it hadn't been for me, and many other other seniors don't have an advocate, well, he could have died at home. I mean, he almost did, when, you know, overnight one night. But how are we dealing with situations like that in emergency departments? Because they continue all the time. That's something I'm interested in here. And we're not just like Winnipeg sends people home in taxis. I'm sure that happens here too. I can't vouch for it, but it's a concern of mine.
I wish I had a solution for you. I think that the regional health authorities need to hear from the people who use the services. I was told many, many years ago, don't just come with a problem, bring along a solution. Well, you know, maybe we should not only knock on the door with some of the issues we identify, but we should also offer some potential solutions. Because when you've lived with the issue, you might have some real insight into the solution. I do recall a point in time where I had an issue with the RHA, and there's a line that you can actually call and complain, and I did. And I actually got a phone call back. And I don't know that there was much done after that, but at least it started the ball rolling. I sympathize with your issue, and it's not a particular aging issue. It's an issue across the board for people accessing emergency services, and sometimes it's appropriate or inappropriate use, and other times it's people don't take things as seriously as they maybe should. So I would just suggest to you to have open line communication with your regional health authority, and there is a line for that, and there are people that you can talk to. But I wouldn't hesitate, if I've got some issues, to have a conversation and bring along some solutions as well for them to consider.
Thank you.